So obviously, intuition is considered as something very important in chess. And for example, if you talk about Magnus Carlsen, one of the first words which is going to be mentioned is intuition. He has a great intuitive understanding of the game, he's more intuitive than Caruana, and so on and so forth. At the same time, it's interesting that this same term, the same term intuition, is used with players who have a totally different style. So for example, Petrosian was a very defensive player. He liked very calm positions, solid positions. He loved strategy, was strategic positions. And of course, he had great intuition. But at the same time, you had a player like Mikhail Tal, who liked wild combinations. He played totally risky sacrifices. There was a lot of speculation and so on. And people said, this guy has a great intuition as well. So here, it's kind of interesting that people with totally different styles are both intuitive. And in fact, intuition is very interesting from a scientific point of view. And a fair amount of research has been done on intuition in science, in particular in research into chess. I'm going to give you just a very quick overview of what has been done on chess psychology. If you want more details, you can check my book about the psychology of chess. First, let's try to define intuition, and there are many, many different definitions in psychology. And in a paper with Philip Chassis, we tried to kind of summarize different definitions and put them in just one big definition. And we have five criteria. The first one is that it's about rapid perception. So intuition is about things that you understand very quickly. You don't spend 10 minutes to understand something. You need only like 5 seconds. Also, you don't have any awareness about what's going on. So if you ask Carlsen why he played, I don't know, knight e1 in some game, he's not going to tell you how he was able to do it. He's going to look at you and look at you like an idiot and say, well, it's obvious. I just see it, why can't you see it? Okay? And then there is the presence of emotions that occur very, very quickly. So if you show a position to a grandmaster, he or she is going to say, I love it. Or he's going to say, this one's structure is really disgusting. Okay? So very quickly, you have very strong emotions. Also, what you have is a kind of holistic understanding of the problem situation. So you understand not only one small aspect, but the entire thing. And also, you don't understand first one small part, and then one small part, and then one small part. Everything is understood as a whole, and that's why it's so quick. And the final criterion we had is that intuition must be correct more often than not. Because if you don't have this criterion, then you just guess. You see a new position, you say, oh, white is better, but you have no clue at all. So you need some kind of validity criterion. So these criteria are not new. They're basically what you find in the literature, but we put them together. And people in general would agree with them. And there has been a lot of research about intuition. And in chess, there is a very old paper in 1907 by an American guy called Cleveland, who studied the psychology of chess. That's the title of the paper. And he was very interested in intuition. And he used a, I would say, relatively simple approach, which is to use questionnaires and also use introspection. So just ask people, what do you think is intuition, and so on. But he clearly identified that intuition was key in the chess, and he called that the positional sense, which we also find actually in chess books. In a very famous study in 1946, Adrian de Groot studied chess using a variety of experiments, and he looked both at perception, memory, and problem solving. And one of his key conclusions is that intuition is really central in chess. And even if you, well, so far I've talked about intuition as something that happens very quickly, within 5 seconds. And the Groot sense went beyond that. He argued that intuition is going to pervade chess thinking. So even if you think for 15 minutes, in fact, most of what you are doing is to use your intuition. And the idea is quite simple, but even if you search a few moves, so you go down a line, you have to evaluate the position. And typically, good players evaluate the position well by pattern recognition, by intuition. And in a book about science in general, Polanyi argued that intuition is central in science as well. He called that tacit knowledge, that's the title of his book. And he said that we can know more than we can tell. And his book is very interesting, and he very powerfully argued that really intuition is everywhere in science. But the way this idea that we can know that more than what we can tell is also now central in the psychology, in a field called implicit learning or implicit cognition. And in fact, many of the decisions you are making are not based on conscious thoughts, which is a bit disappointing, because we would like to be in control of our lives and so on, but apparently a lot of our decisions are implicit as well, so we don't really know why we make decisions. In another famous paper by Chase and Simon in 1973, they tried to provide mechanisms for the data provided by the group, and they argued that intuition is by pattern recognition. So basically, the reason why chess players can, after a few seconds, tell you that white is better is simply that they recognize a few patterns on the board, and there is some information attached with the patterns, and they just retrieve that very quickly. So there is no thinking at all, it's just automatic, in fact it's just perception in a sense. And in a different approach, Dreyfus and Dreyfus argue that expertise is intuition. And they have a bit of an extreme approach, which I think is not quite correct, but it's interesting anyway. So they argue that an expert who is able to evaluate a chess position within 5 seconds is really an expert, and is acting like an expert. However, if the expert needs to think for 10 minutes, then that person goes down to a level which is not the level of expert. Now, of course, you might ask what Caruana and Carlsen were doing, because they typically didn't make a move after 5 seconds. And in fact, I asked once the question to Hubert Dreyfus, who is a philosopher, was a philosopher, died I think 1 year ago. And he couldn't really answer. So I think he pushed the idea of intuition a bit too far. But their book was, still it's very, very influential. The idea that as soon as you think, you are not acting like an expert. Again, I think it's a mistake, but it's a very common idea. It's partly correct in the sense that obviously experts do have intuition. Now I've presented a variety of ideas about intuition. But something that's important to realize is that it is actually quite hard to find data to support the idea of intuition, because things happen very quickly, and you cannot ask people because they don't know. And there is really a difficult question about how you collect data about intuition. And in fact, a lot of research about intuition has been carried out about chess. And I'm going to briefly mention a few things that have been done. Well, first, going back to the Groot, of course, the Groot argued that perception is central to expertise, and perception is obviously linked to intuition. And the Groot basically collected protocols where players, from strong amateurs to world champions, were supposed to find the best move in the position. And what you find in the protocols is that very quickly, after a few seconds, the good players propose moves which are pretty good. And what he said is that good, especially grandmasters, are able to see good moves very quickly. And he emphasized the scene, that it's something visual. So they look at the position, and in fact they see that the bishop has taken d5. Well, the bishop is still on a2. So this is again very perceptual kind of activity. Also, the group developed a task where you have to memorize a chess position presented for a few seconds. And because it's very quick, you don't have time to think too much. And grandmasters can memorize chess positions just after 2-3 seconds almost perfectly. So again, that's the idea that things happen very quickly and it's perceptual. Also, if you record eye movements, which the group did, and I wrote a book about that with him in 1996, you can see that again, in the first seconds, there are differences in the anglophones. Very quickly, the good players, especially the masters, zoom in onto the important squares of the board. And you find that in both in memory tasks, problem-solving tasks, and by the way, you find that in those other fields as well. So for example, in radiology, if you look at the eye movements of experts and non-experts, the experts very quickly go to where the action is. So it's, again, very impressive, that links to this idea of intuition. Now you can also look at empirical evidence about the choice of a move. Something that the group also showed is that the search is very selective, well, partly because the grandmasters find a good move very quickly, they don't know to look at other moves anyway. But they really looked at just three or four moves in the kind of 35 moves you can have at the beginning. So again, highly selective search. And there has been a variety of experiments where you ask players of different levels to find a good move in the position. In one study I did with Guillermo Campitelli, we found that grandmasters were able to solve 50% of the position of the problems within 10 seconds. So again, very quick. I mean, this is not surprising for chess players, but still we have data showing that. In the paper by Klein, they showed that the first move proposed is very often the best one. Again, this idea of very selective search, and very quickly you find the good move. There are also some data which are not supporting this idea. There was a recent paper in 2012 where, in fact, the first move didn't predict much of the skill or the final choice. So it might be the case that the kind of positions you choose have an effect about whether the first move you mentioned is a good move or the good move or not. Now, you could argue that finding a move is not really about intuition in a sense because it's about searching, looking at different possibilities, and this is in a sense more analytical thinking. And in fact, one of my criteria was that you should have a holistic understanding of the problem solution, and in many chess problems you can find the solution looking at only one part of the board. So you don't satisfy this criterion. So one idea would be to look at task where players have to evaluate positions rather than to find the best move. And there were a few studies about that, for example by Holding in 79 and Charnes in 91. They did find that the quality of evaluations did correlate with the skill level. However, there were a few problems with their studies. For example, the presentation time was relatively long. In one study, I think it was about 1 minute. So in 1 minute, you don't talk about intuition anymore, it's about other things. And also the skill level was relatively low. The best players had were weak experts. So we thought that we should carry out an experiment where we have better data. And by the way, this research has been carried out in collaboration with Philippe Chassy, André Didier Jean, and Rick Lyon. And so basically, we did an experiment where the task is to evaluate chess positions. And we had 46 players, including 10 female players. The average age was 31 years. And the sample was very, very strong. In fact, it's probably the strongest sample ever, maybe after the sample used by Adrien de Groot. So we had 9 candidate masters with an average of 21 ELO points, 11 masters with an average of 23 ELO points, 11 international players, an average of about 2,500 points, and 15 world-class players with an average of 2,700 points. So especially the last group is the very best players. I think we had 5 at the time. We collected the data quite a while ago, I think 5 or 6 years ago. And we had 5 of the 10 best players in the world. So it's very neat sample. So we used the 56 positions, which were randomly chosen from a large database, except that we rejected positions which were obviously totally crazy. So in the middle of an exchange, of a combination where we have a big imbalance in material. Each position was used using a Fritz 12, which tells you about the age of the study, by the way. And One measure we use is the evaluation error, which is the distance between the way Fritz was evaluating the position and what players were proposing. And we manipulated two variables in addition to the skill level. So first, we manipulated the complexity of the positions. So some positions were simple and others complex. And we basically used the number of pieces in the position, which correlates very highly with the number of possibilities on the board. And then we also manipulated the balance of the position. So in some positions, white was better. In others, black was better. And in others, the position was equal. Then we showed each position for 5 seconds. Then the screen became blank. And this scale appeared, which is very well known to chess players. And basically, they had to click on one of the 7 points. And there was no limit to evaluate the position, but I'm going to show you in a few seconds that players were very quick to do it. And also, before the real experiment started, they had 5 practice trials. So here we have the response time as a function of the skill level, whether white, black is better, or whether it's equality, and as a function of the complexity as well. And as you can see, players were very quick. So most of the answers were within 2.5 seconds or 3 seconds. Now, this is not 2.5 seconds after they see the position. They see the position for 5 seconds and then 2.5 seconds. And maybe, by the way, a better way to do the experiment would be to ask people to evaluate the position right away. So I think some players could be much quicker than that. And if you look at the effect of the variables we were measuring, there was no effect of skill or complexity. So all players were equally quick. However, the players tended to be a bit slower when they evaluated positions where they had a disadvantage, so where black was better. By the way, they always saw the position with white, they were always playing white. Now, if you look at the evaluation error, which is the most interesting variable, we find that there was a main effect of skill, which is not surprising, but still we could show that very clearly. Also, there was an effect of complexity, and again, not surprisingly, the simpler positions were evaluated better than the complex positions. And also, there was an effect of balance. And the result is interesting. I'm not quite sure what it means. And the result is that the equal positions were evaluated less precisely than the positions where white or black was better. So equality was a bit harder to evaluate. So here we have the, in a sense, the raw data. We have the ELO rating on the x-axis, the y rating on the y-axis, we have the error size. And of course, the lower the error, the better, so you want to be close to zero. And as you can see, the better player are closer to zero and you get this wonderful regression line. So the results are very, very clear. Of course, there is variability. You always find these kind of things, but still the trend is very clear. In fact, skill accounted for 50% of the variance, which is quite high, and I'll come back to that in a few seconds. If you want the exact regression line, you have it here. And now I'm going to play a game which is a bit speculative, but it's quite fun. So I'm going to ask the question, what kind of level do you need to have perfect intuition? I mean, these players obviously were good, but they were far from a zero. So they are, the best were at like 0.9. So there was still some way to go down. So if you extrapolate from the data, you find that in order to reach perfect intuition, you need to have an ELO of 41-31, which is obviously very high. So even Carlsen, who is very famous for his intuition, has an ELO of only 28-35. So maybe Carlsen is not as intuitive as people think, but of course he's more intuitive than most of us. And even the best computer, and here I put Dogfish, but it's probably AlphaZero now, has an ELO of only 56. So there's still a way, some way to go to get perfect intuition. Now very quickly, a discussion. Well, I told you that skill accounted for 50% of the variance, which is very high, but in fact, I think it should be higher because we have something that's called the restriction of range. We are only players above 2,000 ELO. So if you had players below 2,000 ELO, they would be, of course, much weaker than the one we had, and that would increase the variance that explained for. And yeah, it's easy to collect data. I'm going to do that at some point, but I'm quite sure the variance explained is going to be much higher. So in general, these results support the idea that holistic intuition, which are defined by the ability to evaluate a position, this intuition is central to expertise. So I was told to be short. I think I was short. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.